in you, baby.
Hold on. All right. So, welcome to tonight's, it's not really my presentation on Gilded Age urbanization. Okay. Let's see. Very good. Okay, so welcome to this installment of the Gilded Age, the emergence of urban America. So kind of the context is behind this is that the United States, after the United States Civil War, is going to essentially go through, in effect, the Second Industrial Revolution. And as it does, the nation is on a path of transforming itself from a primarily agrarian nation to a more industrialized nation. Now, of course, transformation that will be experienced is this transformation from a predominantly rural nation to a predominantly urban country as well. So we tie the development of urban America to industrialization, the Industrial Revolution going on during the Gilded Age period. So in looking at this unit, I really want you to pay attention to the theme, one of the seven thematic areas that we study in AP US history, and that's the one of migration and movement. You know, the Gilded Age is really a story of migration and movement. Shifts of the population from within the country, and of course, population shifts to the United States. So this is so we try to couple the urbanization unit with the immigration phenomenon that the U.S. experienced during the Gilded Age. So, you know, we tend to think, you know, as it says here, it says the frontier was considered to be a safety valve, according to Frederick Jackson Turner. In his influential frontier thesis, its cheap land afforded a release for the population pressures mounting in the cities. So, you know, if there was going to be any migration during this period, you would think that the primary migration during the Gilded Age would be to the New West. People taking advantage of the Homestead Act, people in pursuit of precious metals, and venturing beyond the mountains to the mining frontier, those that sought to round up wild cattle, just roaming free in the American Southwest, and take up lives of ranchers, or those brave American pioneers who ventured into the great American desert in order to become farmers. But ultimately, what we do know is that the New West is largely going to be settled by immigrants. What is it, 80% of those who settled in the New West were first-generation Americans. So if you would think, that during the Gilded Age that the major migration stream was the movement out to the frontier, and that was actually wrong. It was backwards. The flow to the cities, the flow of the population from the rural areas to the cities turned out to be greater than the movement of people to the West. Now, when you think of urbanization during the Gilded Age, there's no question that the rapid urbanization occurring in the Northeast, the industrial centers in the North. But I want you to think about the urbanization is in fact growing. These cities, these urban areas are growing at a faster clip in the West and in the Midwest and, of course, in the South. As you can see, the Pacific Coast is going to become urbanized with, in large part, due to mining and the railroads. You know, one of the things that you're going to hear from me is that one of the most important city builders of the Gilded Age period are the railroads. The railroads are what are going to bring and are going to give birth to urban areas really throughout the United States, throughout the country. Los Angeles, for example, was the terminus, the western terminus of the Southern Pacific Railroad, which stretched from New Orleans to LA. Seattle was a terminal point of three transcontinental roads, including the Great Northern Railroad, which stretched from Duluth, Minnesota to Seattle. So, and of course, as we mentioned in class during the New West, is that every 20 miles or so along these transcontinental railroads, little villages and towns would pop up. Places in Kansas that were called railheads, cow towns, where cattle were to be loaded on board railroads to be sent east, become towns, become major cities. Places like Minneapolis, St. Paul, Omaha, Kansas City, Denver, places that were just mere villages prior to the war, become major metropolitan areas by 1900. And of course, the South and all of its cash crops and cotton and sharecropping, it too produced towns and significant population centers like Durham, North Carolina, which owes its success to the tobacco road, tobacco production, the whole tobacco industry. Birmingham, Alabama, which of course was called the Pittsburgh of the South because of its iron and steel industries. Houston, do I have to mention? Dallas, Fort Worth, cowtowns, the ranching, Miami and its tourism, and Tulsa, Oklahoma with its oil. So, you know, you take an image like this and you know, if I were to give you a few minutes to look, then it's okay, predict the city in 1880. Well, the mountains in the backdrop kind of give it away. This is Denver, Colorado. Denver, Colorado. This is an image also from 1880. Try to find images from the same year. And this is Memphis, Tennessee. Now, what I like about this photo, if you notice, it is reflections of this new modern city. It's a reflection of this new modern city. You can see this transition from using horse and buggy to using rail. You can see the rail down here is laid into the roads, and you can see the streetcar in the distance. You can also see the electricity poles, telephone poles, which of course brings electricity and communication into the big city. So any guesses as to this city? 1880. That's Burney, Texas. Always like looking at the old pictures of these old cities and kind of overlap them into how they look today. But, you know, before the Gilded Age, the major empire builders, the major city builders, the larger cities in the United States were ports. They were ports. They were on water. Rivers were the city builders. Now, as I mentioned before, it's the clustering of railroads. It's the building of the railroads that are going to bring about this new urbanization. Of course, the railroads are going to bring to these cities huge concentrations of labor and, of course, a proliferation of services to handle the needs of that labor. In raw numbers, 50-year period, 1860 to 1910, population in incorporated towns grew from 6 to 45 million, or almost 50% of the entire population becomes urban. By 1920, for the first time, city dwellers will outnumber rural dwellers. But while the Far West had its greatest proportion of population growth, the Northeast, of course, was just absolutely exploding in terms of the numbers of people going into the cities. And we were rapidly becoming what Jefferson really was hoping wouldn't happen. Hold on a second. Okay. So, and that's what he said, you know, Jefferson, Thomas Jefferson hated cities. You know, he one day envisioned that people would be, quote, you can see here, piled high up on one another in the cities. And worse, the people living in these cities would be increasingly landless, toolless, and homeless, an urban proletariat with nothing to offer but their labor to sell. And, you know, the idea is that the United States, you know, this country, the promise of America was always rooted in property, owning your own property, owning your own home. And this new industrial urban world, this new urban industrial nation that we have, was rapidly creating a country where it made very difficult for its citizens to acquire property. For example, if you look in 1900, more than 90% of the residents in Manhattan were renters. Boston, Fall River, Jersey City, Memphis, 80% of the inhabitants were renters. And this is something that Jefferson loved about agrarianism, is that it promoted private property ownership. People owned their own farms. They had a greater stake. They had a greater stake into what was going on because they had land. They had property. But when you look at these images, you look at Manhattan in 1900, and again, you can see the blending of, actually, you see fewer horses now, where now transportation is largely being carried out by more advanced through more advanced technological means. Obviously, at the beginning of the Gilded Age or near the height of the Gilded Age, when we're talking about the nature of American cities, you do go from that horse and buggy to this more of a modern approach. Now, in order for cities to grow, as I mentioned, these cities were growing so fast that city government really could not keep up. But in order to accommodate the growth, cities, the skyline during the Gilded Age, the American city skyline changed. Buildings got taller, and cities grew out and wider beyond where they were. In order to accommodate the large numbers of people, the skyline of American cities had to get taller. How did they do it? Technology, innovation, steel frame construction. Carnegie Steel is going to be the builder of cities in the Gilded Age. Not only is this steel going to be used to construct the railroads, but also to build the cities. And so you add the steel frames to Louis Sullivan's architecture, what do we get? Voila, the skyscraper. And you know, these tall buildings aren't really practical without the elevator. So Elijah Otis is going to invent the elevator, which really makes these sky rises, these skyscrapers, a little bit more practical. So, and this is, I took this picture because this is kind of your typical Gilded Age architectural style, built to, like I said, accommodate more and more people flooding into the cities. You had in these cities, you had areas where the haves lived and you had areas where the have-nots. And this consequently is the Vanderbilt Mansion in New York City. Definitely a ritzy, high-class area of town, only to be contrasted by this, which I think we'd get this image of squalor, urban squalor in the jungle. The Jungle is a great book because you really get a feel for, you know, the cities and how these cities were set up. But here's your, I think your vertical growth in cities. This is your what I think you're envisioning with your skyscraper and being able to pile people on top of one another in these cities. All right, so you got vertical growth and horizontal growth. In order for cities to grow, they had to expand outward in order to accommodate the growth. And this is mass transit. So I want you to think about examples of mass transit. It enabled people to live far away from work, where you could live 15 miles from work, but commute. Talks about most workers became commuters during the Gilded Age. So you're talking about subways, streetcars, steel cable suspension bridge technology. These bridges enabled large metropolitan areas to grow over water. You know, eventually by the time we get to the 1920s, the automobile is going to lead to even further horizontal growth of cities, leading to suburbanization and eventually urban decay. But subways, of course, the first American city to build a subway was Boston. Chicago, of course, had its elevated streetcars, and San Francisco had their electric streetcars as well. So, and with the steel cable bridge, or the bridge technologies, this is the construction. Now, obviously, it's not done. It's not anywhere close. But this is the beginnings of the George Washington Bridge, built across the East River, connecting the East River and the, or across the East River, connecting New Jersey to New York. This is also one of the most famous Gilded Age projects. This is the Brooklyn Bridge, connecting two of the big boroughs in New York together, spanning water. Then, of course, you have the this bridge. I like this one. This is actually was funded and built by Carnegie using Carnegie steel, and this is the Eads Bridge in St. Louis, which, of course, is going to allow St. Louis to grow across the Mississippi River. Okay. Yeah. Now, another very important event towards urbanization is the 1892 World's Fair in Chicago, which really started a city beautification movement across the country. So what happens every 4 years, they have what they call World's Fairs. World Fairs were kind of like tech shows where, people would come to see the latest technology, where the latest gadgets and technologies would be demonstrated and kind of like, it's like an exposition. People would go and see new things that are being created. The previous World's Fair was in Paris in 1888. And they knew that the World's Fair in 1892 would be in the United States because it was the 400th birthday or the 400th anniversary of Columbus discovering America. So Chicago won the bid. To host. They wanted to out-Eiffel, the Paris, right? The Paris one in 1888. And so what they wanted to do to out-Eiffel is to light Chicago up, to light it up at night, the electric lights. And they called, of course, Chicago became known as the White City. And here you can see the Expo Center, where all the exhibits were located. This is the area of Chicago that was built to accommodate the World's Fair. The World's Fair lasted for months, and people would travel far and wide from outside the country and all across the United States to the World's Fair. You can see in the background the Ferris wheel. The Ferris wheel was unveiled for the first time. Also kind of interesting, at the Chicago World's Fair in 1892, Wrigley Spearmint Chewing Gum. A Chicago favorite, I guess, was unveiled for the first time. It was also at this expo that historian Frederick Jackson Turner read for the first time his frontier thesis to captivated audiences. But what happened, people came to Chicago and they saw the museums, the hotels, the restaurants. They saw how clean the city was, the technology, the electricity, the use of electricity, the light bulb. And they said, you know what, we have to do this with our city. So it started in Chicago. It started this beautification movement all across the United States. But the problems in the cities, you do need to know this. You know, what were the problems of the cities? The number one, you need to know this, the number one problem of the cities is they were overcrowded. They were overcrowded. They were growing way too fast. People were living in these dumbbell tenements. You see that word right here? They were living in these dumbbell tenements that were very poorly constructed, in which these immigrants and the poor, the working poor, just going to be crammed into. If you look at this bullet right here, I always like reading this. In 1900, Manhattan numbered 42,700 tenement buildings, which housed 1.6 million people. That's a very high density. And so what that led to, it led to fires. It led to health problems. It created slums. It pollution was a problem, crime was a problem, drugs, alcohol, you name it. Read the jungle. You know the problems of the cities because the jungle does a pretty good job in broadly touching upon these problems. What made these problems worse is city corruption. You know, the city was incapable of dealing with the problems of the early city. And so political machines, these political organizations, took the place of responsible city government. They provided the services that city government was incapable of delivering. You know, they dealt with issues of transit, street paving, water, sewage, street lighting, street cleaning, fire, police protection, you name it. And so city problems were handled by local political bosses who traded their patronage, favors, and graft for these services. And of course, the big city political machines weren't necessarily altogether sinister because, you know, they did, for what it's worth, they did provide food and money for the poor. They did help fix problems at City Hall and generally helped immigrants adjust to their new life. And so this is one of my favorite images of talking about living in a sardine can. Now, one of the most famous political organizations, political machines, one of these corrupt political organizations, ran the Democratic Party in New York City. It was called Tammany Hall, and Tammany Hall was run by this man. This guy, his name is Boss Tweed, Marcy Tweed, political cartoonist named Thomas Nast made it his career, made it his life's goal to put Boss Tweed behind bars to expose him for being a crook. And he dominated New York City politics by essentially doing favors for immigrants coming off the boat on Ellis Island by providing jobs, by providing shelter, by providing food. He provided these favors in exchange for their immigrant votes. So he'd go into elections with millions of immigrant votes in his back pocket. And so by this, he was able to determine who won political races. He was able to handpick politicians. And so he essentially dominated New York City government, the New York state government, for well over a decade. By the time we turned at the turn of the century in 1904 or so, Mr. Nast is going to go to prison on corruption charges. So this is, you know, the one of the ways in which immigrants were going to be exploited by these Northern Democrats is by doing favors and kickbacks for their votes. So, but we want to understand too, what drew people to the city? Why did people migrate to the city? And one group, of course, are the youth, people who left the farms in America. They were tired of, they didn't want to be farmers themselves. They believed that economic opportunity was in the city, especially young women. Young farm girls flooded to the city. Single women flooded to the cities. Because it's in the big cities where women have the greatest amount of opportunity, economic opportunity. Plus, you know, the cities had electric lights and amusement parks, newspapers, magazines, telephones. You know, they had shops. They can shop. So this is where young people wanted to be. But the cities weren't all great. I found a couple of pictures here just showing the electric wires. You know, can you imagine? Holy smoke. So that's really one of the, there's a couple more topics. One is the new immigrants. These are the newcomers that come to the United States. There's two waves of immigrants that enter the United States during the 19th century. The first group come before the Civil War and they're called the old immigrants. The second wave are called the new immigrants. And this is during the Gilded Age and into the 20th century. And you need to know the difference between the two. And a lot of it had to do with their origins. The new immigrants came from Eastern and Southern Europe, okay? Whereas old immigrants came from North and Western Europe. New immigrants for the most part, were extremely poor. They were poorer than the old immigrants. They didn't speak English. And they largely came from areas of Eastern and Southern Europe that were heavily Catholic and Jew. You know, they didn't assimilate very well. And for that reason, they will suffer even greater nativism than what the old immigrants did before the Civil War period. So, but they were attracted here. They were attracted here. They were recruited here for their cheap labor. That's why they were let in. Despite all the nativism, it was the want of cheap labor that drove these new immigrants into the United States. And they come from many different backgrounds, Latin, Slavic, Jewish background of Southern and Eastern Europe. And there were Russians, Italians, Poles, Serbs, Lithuanians. That's the jungle, right? Hungarians, Bohemians, Romanians, Croats, Slovaks, Slovenes, and Greeks. And then they piled into those dumbbell tenements on top of one another, and they languished in absolute poverty. But we got to understand why, what lured them. And of course, when they came here, the new immigrants did segregate themselves from the rest of their countrymen. They lived in, the Italians congregated in certain neighborhoods, the Greeks congregated in certain neighborhoods. And I got a quote here. It's pretty good. Jacob Riis, the guy you're going to need to know, in his book, How the Other Half Lives, he says, you know, if you took a map of the city, talking about New York, if you took a map of the city and colored it to designate nationalities, it would show more stripes than a zebra and more colors than any rainbow, just by looking at the ethnic neighborhoods. But just looking at just unbelievable numbers of immigrants in the United States, in 1890, 4 out of every 5 New Yorkers were foreign born. That's a higher proportion than any other city in the world. New York had essentially the largest, New York City was the largest Irish city in the world. It was one of the largest German cities in the world. And it was up there in terms of being one of the largest Italian cities in the world. So, I mean, we're talking about massive, massive numbers of new immigrants that pile into the cities. Make sure you need to know what pulled them here. Why did they come here? You know, they came here because they were fleeing persecution. They saw America as a land of opportunity for economic employment, economic opportunities. I think the jungle suffices well there. Many of these Europeans were recruited by industrialists to come for their cheap labor. Many came to escape the draft, compulsory military service, especially in Italy. And of course, overcrowding and unemployment in Europe, as well as famine. But they came. And here's the waves. You saw a bit of a drop there in the 1890s. That's when the United States went through that depression. But after the depression was over, it picked back up. And of course, they come in through Ellis Island between that 50-year period, 1870 and 1920, an average of 5,000 new immigrants a day were processed. 2% were turned away, usually political radicals and people who had diseases, people who were sick, were turned away. And that's one constant, is that the U.S. government has always closed the door for people who are sick. You're not allowed to come in here if you're sick. Overwhelming majority hopped off the boat, right into the city, right into the factory, or right into the unemployment line, right into some pretty. So there's Ellis Island. Now, yes, Ellis Island is not the Statue of Liberty. Of course, you sail next to the Statue of Liberty on your way to Ellis Island. And, of course, they piled on board those ships waiting their long voyage across the Atlantic to the United States, where they arrive at Ellis Island, where they are quickly given physicals. They pass the physical. They move on to the next station. And that's what the stations look like right down here, where you are processed as an American citizen. The government really put you through the ringer. They gave you a really hard test that you had to pass, a number of tests that you had to pass in order to get in. But Uncle Sam was very willing to take them, in large part due to politics, especially democratic politics. And of course, because of their cheap labor. And you can see there's many different classes of immigrants here, but mostly they're extremely, extremely poor. Okay. Extremely poor. And this is where they're working. You got immigrant children working in the factories, you know, and the nativists, not only did the immigrants have to face difficult living and working conditions, but they had to confront the growing prejudice from Native Americans, many of them whom saw these new immigrants as a direct threat to their way of life, their culture, and their jobs. As one American laborer said, quote, "Immigrants work for almost nothing and seem to be able to live on the wind, something I cannot do." Others saw immigrants as a threat to traditional American culture and values. A Stanford University professor called them, quote, "illiterate, docile, lacking self-reliance and initiative, and not possessing the Anglo-Saxon conceptions of law, order, and government." You know, many feared that in these immigrants, well, a lot of this nativism was rooted in anti-Catholicism, anti-Semitism, the fact that these immigrants were willing to work for what were called starvation wages. These new immigrants were also oftentimes used as scab workers, used to break strikes. So working men and women didn't really like these immigrants because they were usually, you know, during strikes, they would take their jobs from them. Their failure to learn the English language, their quirkiness, you know, they tended to dress different and their haircuts are a little bit different. And they had just different cultural differences that brought the bullies out. Failure to assimilate. In fact, they did segregate themselves in cities, city neighborhoods. Many of them were socialists, anarchists, and immigrants were the ones that tended to join labor unions. And labor unions were fairly unpopular. Their high birth rates, and of course, their different ethnicities. Prominent nativists, Josiah Strong, and the American Protective Association. So these are two no-card terms that we want to make sure we own. An act of Congress that was actually passed in response to nativism. This nativism we're talking about is the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882, where European immigrants began to be more prominent in terms of taking jobs in the West. So therefore, the need for Chinese labor declined. So the door to Chinese labor or Chinese immigration was slammed shut in 1882. And there's absolutely no doubt that this was a byproduct of racism. Okay. So. But as I mentioned in class, if the United States were to look itself in the mirror in 1880, the reflection that it would see is the big city. The city was essentially a symbol of everything right with the country, where you know you have the new technologies and the industrialization and the wealth and all that. But the cities were also a reflection of everything that was wrong in the country. You saw segregation, you saw ethnic prejudice, and racism, you had extreme poverty, awful working conditions, living conditions, you know. So the city was kind of a microcosm of really the country itself. But what came out of the, the vile nature of the American city was this need to reform the cities, to improve the living and working conditions in the cities. And so you need to know what the driving forces were that caused people to desire to reform the cities. One is if we do not help the working poor, especially if you want to write next to this, you want to write public education. By providing public schools for immigrant children, providing public education, expanding public education for the working classes, is the fear is that if we don't do this, then the working poor would revolt. Also, a big development in the Gilded Age into the Progressive Era is this concept of social gospel. The idea that salvation is not necessarily an individual pursuit. I think that salvation for heaven, salvation for for the next world, is mainly an individual pursuit. The thinking among many of these social gospelites is that salvation is secured through a communal effort to do good, to serve those who are weak. So social gospelites are going to move. They're going to move into the cities, and they are going to provide aid for the working poor who are languishing in the cities. You know, of course, cities were viewed as places of sin, wickedness. You know, this is where you had prostitution and drug use and alcohol. Darwin is actively being promoted there. So a lot of these Christian social reformers, we're talking about ministers and churches, are going to move into the cities in order to do battle against Satan. And then lastly, a big driving force is this Victorian English culture. You know, the Gilded Age is also the Victorian Age. And so we have this new Christian morality that is really taking hold. And of course, the cities were the place is where it's going to flourish. So examples of social gospel, obviously don't concern yourself with the whole thing. I think bullet number three is prominent. You need to make sure you know the Settlement House movement, Jane Addams, Hull House. These are these institutions that were built in city centers, are right among the poor, right among the immigrants. And these homes, these houses, these settlement houses were settled by middle-class women, social gospelite women like Jane Addams. Hull House is the very first one. And these houses provide services. They provide, you know, English classes. They provide classes in nutrition and baby care for immigrant women. They provide help for single women who are being exploited in the city. So Jane Addams becomes the first woman and the first American ever to win the Nobel Peace Prize on behalf of the urban poor. Lillian Ward, she followed Jane Addams's lead and brought the Settlement House movement to New York City. And before you know it, settlement houses are, you know, in Europe, you know, but it started in Chicago. Another social gospelite is Florence Kelly, a woman who fought for shorter working hours for women and children and succeeded. So the reform movements in the cities, you know, how best can you improve the lives of working people, the working poor in the cities? Number one is alcohol. In the jungle, you need to really, really pay attention to the impact that alcohol has in Packingtown and on Yurgis and his family. So we want to take note of the Women's Christian Temperance Union led by Frances Willard. Of course, these temperance unions are primarily almost 100% female and middle class. Frances Willard, one of my favorite, and I actually have a video online about Carrie Nation. This is a woman who lost her husband to alcohol and decided to go on, spend the rest of her life on a crusade to fight the drink, you know, and she did it with a little hatchet. She carried around a hatchet. She'd walk into bars and destroy that. She'd go behind the bars and destroy the bottles, chop up the kegs. But she dedicated her life to purging America of its thirst for drink. And one of the most important prohibition organizations to come out of the Gilded Age and into the Progressive Era is the Anti-Saloon League, arguably one of the most successful anti-alcohol organizations in the United States, going well into the 1920s. So other problems, obviously prostitution, you're going to see that in the jungle. Other vices like crimes, drugs, things like that, narcotics, gambling, big problems in the cities. But the women in the cities, these reformers are going to go in And this is where we're going to start to see this push for female suffrage. And so we see the establishment of the North American Women's Suffrage Association, which this is where this push for women's suffrage is going to come from this urban city movements. Churches are going to move into the cities in order to wage battle against sin, right? Dwight Lyman Moody's probably the most famous of all the urban revivalists, try to bring a kind of a great awakening type movement into the cities. Talk about education. Reformers, make sure that for these reformers, the ones that are starred, those are non-negotiables, absolutely need to know them. Many of these other ones are note card terms, which means you need to know them, but the ones that are starred are pretty big. So we want to just, obviously many of these individuals are, you know, socialists. They are, and of course we could throw in this list of eventually Upton Sinclair, but they're socialists. They're wanting to use the power of the press, the pen to really expose problems in order to bring to light a lot of truths, to try to, like I said, bring to mind, to the public mind, a lot of the abuses of the urban, industrial urban areas. Okay. And of course, rounding this out, with the beginning of the Gilded Age in this new urban industrial America, we do see a shift in literature and art. It's called realism. And so with realism, really the only person you need to know, he's a note card term, and that's Mark Twain. In fact, Mark Twain, he's the gentleman who actually coined the phrase, the Gilded Age. And he said it out of sarcasm. You know, gilded means golden, like this is our golden age. But, you know, in our golden age, we had corruption. We had, you know, not everybody was really benefiting. Not everybody's really benefiting from it. So anyway, so you got real, and then of course the art. We'll spend time looking at the art from the urban industrial area. If you actually look at, and I'm going to come down here. Exit. Okay, I'm going to find. Go to APUSH Art here. If you come down to industrialization and urbanization, you could really see. You can really see that really the goal of art is that the romanticism is over. What killed romanticism was 700,000 dead Americans in the Civil War, and now this gilded age. So we'll make sure we look at a few of these in class. But you look at these urban images and see if you can find some commonalities. If you can find some trends, see how well you can do. Right? I love that one right there. We'll talk about these. Whistler's Mother, very famous work. The Loneliness of City Life. It's like you live in a city of a million people, but you're alone. You're so impersonal. Cities, you know, people who live in cities, they're people, you know, I don't know. I'm not going to go there. Cities playing, you know, kids basically raising themselves. Yeah, but you can go through here. I love that one. This is the Victorian age where women dressed very conservatively, right? Sexual norms were very conservative. Oh, amazing stuff. So, yeah, There we go. If we go back to the Gilded Age, urbanization, what we need to do is look at, this one's a big one. I know it's on your reading list, 5-point slum, a really interesting article. The women of the settlement house movement is one of them as well. Okay. Don't remember what the other ones were, but anyway, oh, How the Other Half Lives, the video on Jacob Riis. That's big. And the four virtues of true womanhood. That's there as well. Okay. So anyway, gang, this has been Gilded Age Urbanization. And I am going to leave it there. Have a good one. Have a great night.